Welcome back to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. The religious right isn't as vocal as they used to be in American politics, but they still have that enormous amount of power with the right-wing politicians in this country. Almost every policy idea from the Tea Party can be traced back to the religious right, and I have author Frank Schaeffer with me now to tell us about how the religious right's new plans aren't all that great for where America is headed. Frank, the holy war continues, and we saw some element of that is basic, is the shutdown. We're seeing it, whether it's dealing with global warming or evolution, this holy war that simply won't go away. We thought it did, but really it's still out there, isn't it?
Yeah, it is indeed, because it goes so far back in American history. I mean, all the way back to the Bay State Colony with the Puritans, if you like, you know, burning the Pequot Indians to death while they stood there and literally read out of the Bible. And if you fast forward to our own point of history and you look at people like Ted Cruz and Sarah Palin before him and the religious right before that, my dad, Francis Schaeffer, and what we were doing in the 70s and 80s on the anti-abortion movement, all these things have something that connect them. And that is the idea that instead of a democracy, what you want is a theocracy where you can stand there and say, we believe the Bible is literally true and everything it affirms, and we want to base America on that. And that is where all these movements share something.
Frank, you've written so much about this. I've followed your career writing about the progression of this. As I put it, it's really a political holy war. There's only way that I know how to put it. You actually start telling the story by what happened in the late 19th century. That's really where all this started, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. You know, my dad was someone who came out of the battles of the 1920s and 30s in seminaries like Princeton Theological Seminary, where a new movement of liberal theology that wanted to question whether everything the Bible said was true in a literal sense began to confront fundamentalism. And then, of course, in the Scopes trial and the whole issue of evolution being taught in schools, this all came to a head. And out of that battle, a group of evangelicals led by Billy Graham, Christianity Today magazine, Carl Henry and others, and my father, decided they needed to rebrand the movement and call what had been fundamentalism evangelicalism, but without actually changing the terms of the debate. They just gave it a softer, gentler name. And that's the movement I came out of in the 70s and 80s when I was my dad's sidekick in the rise of the religious right. We were touring the country trying to rile up the troops on issues like standing against legalized abortion after Roe v. Wade and these other things. But the anger of that movement that persists to today with people like Ted Cruz and the shutdown comes right out of the debates between the fundamentalists and evangelicals on one side and liberal and progressive people on the other side who had a more tolerant and urbane view of these things.
Frank, how is it that, I mean, I can understand them, the religious right getting involved in issues such as evolution or global warming. It's still a mystery to me. Don't get me wrong. It's just bizarre to me. But then when you start saying, well, they also want to be involved in the tax issues, because that's really what the shutdown was about, is you had Republicans who were unwilling to raise taxes on multi-billion dollar corporations. When you drill right down to it, that's what was about. How is this money issue such a big issue for evangelicals?
Because they've been bought. I mean, look at Billy Graham's 95th birthday party. Look at the photographs of him sitting there with Rupert Murdoch and Donald Trump and other far-right business leaders, or with Sarah Palin, who borrowed evangelist Billy Graham's and his son's plane to go on her book tour to promote the idea of a Christian America. This has all been one and the same. Look, what happened was, is back in the 70s and 80s when Dad and I were out there on the so-called pro-life hustings, we were outsiders. Now, the former outsider agitators who, like us, used to go to people like Gerald Ford and President Bush, number one, that is, President Bush, Ronald Reagan and others, knock on their door, ask them to deal with our issues. From that time to this time, there's been a shift. People like Ted Cruz take the views that we held as outsiders. Now they are insiders. And the reason big money and evangelical interests have become one and the same is that it's a quid pro quo. The evangelicals have provided the votes for the Republican Party, and in return, the Republican Party has taken their issues of abortion or standing against gay rights and made them part of the litmus test platform. And what has happened is big money, people like the Koch brothers and others, have used this level of religious delusion and intolerance to their own benefit in terms of their politics. They don't care about these issues. The big money in Republican politics doesn't care. But they like these willing dupes who will get out there and march.
In other words, Frank, they don't really have the people who are most taking advantage of these, you know, really fanatical evangelicals. Not, I wouldn't even say run-of-the-mill evangelical, but true fanatical evangelicals. The people who are taking the most advantage of them have nothing in common, wouldn't let them use their back door, you know, as a service elevator. That's really the ugly part of this story. Is it's almost like they don't even understand they're being used. And in the process, on the other side, they're destroying the Republican Party. Is all but dead at this point because of this whole fanatic kind of image that they seem to portray.
Yeah, and the big money on the right wing, the Koch brothers and others, or Rupert Murdoch and Fox News, or all these kinds of people, they don't care about these issues individually. But what they do care about is trying to win Republican primaries and get their candidates in and others. And of course now, you know, you and I the other day on your radio show were talking about a book of mine, And God Said Billy, that examines the delusional aspect of religion in America. And in that book, in And God Said Billy, what I do is I unpack and show how people who are truly delusional jump into right-wing politics thinking that somehow to be a Christian is to be fill in the blank, against abortion, against gay marriage, whatever it may be. And that those points of view are used by the Republican Party to try to bring voters to the voting booth every election cycle that otherwise would not be there, because they don't actually care about things like the Koch brothers getting lower taxes for billionaires. And global warming all of a sudden only becomes an issue on places like Fox News, who deny it, and evangelicals deny it, because they are kind of doing a payback for those folks who are at the top of the Republican Party making things like abortion and gay rights, standing against gay rights, a litmus test. And so the religious right has accepted the package of the Ayn Rand libertarian far billionaire right that wants no taxes, no regulation, no effort against pollution and so forth, because those guys have financed them.
Frank, let me ask you something. I know your history very well. First of all, people listening to this would never understand that you're extremely religious. You have a real center where it comes to your personal religion. You actually came up through the system as a child, where your father, as you pointed out, was just a remarkably important evangelical moving through the system. When is it that you just said, well, you know, maybe this isn't the right path?
Well, in the late 1980s, you know, my dad died in 1984, and he had cancer for 6 years, and I was filling in for him on the platform. I was the keynote speaker at the Religious Broadcasters Convention to 10,000 people. I shared the platform with Ronald Reagan. I was the keynote speaker at the Southern Baptist one year, I think it was 83 or 84, because my dad was sick and in Mayo Clinic. But then when he died, I really looked at this thing afresh. And did I really want to just inherit this nepotistic mantle in the same way that, for instance, Billy Graham's son Franklin has taken on the mantle of his father and the big paycheck and the plane and all the rest? And it was tempting. And I seriously had questions intellectually. I just stopped believing in the fundamentalist theology of the Bible all being true. I stopped believing in the social movement. I just looked at how ugly the anti-gay part of it was. I looked at how ugly the anti-feminist part of it was, the way women were being treated and the rest, and seriously had a personal crisis of conscience, had a personal crisis in that I was crisscrossing the country in Jerry's jet and doing other things that I no longer believed in. And by the late 1980s, I was on my way out. I wrote a first novel called Portofino. I've written five novels since.
I've read all of them, and they're good. So I guess the point being, Frank, is people to judge what you're saying here need to understand that you have had a lifetime of considering how much damage the real frenzied evangelical right is not just doing to a political party, but to in democracy in general. This divide between secularism and, I guess, literal belief in the Bible has always been there. I mean, as you point out, from the 19th century it started. Then you point out, well, they lost the real frenzied right evangelicals lost the fight in the 19th century. They pouted about it. They were angry about it. They stewed over it. And now they feel they're back in power. And we're just seeing the ugliest part of that right now, aren't we?
Yeah, and you know the interesting thing is I go back far enough. I'm only 61, but still that's a little distance. And I knew people like Jack Kemp well as a personal friend, George Bush Sr. I have a folder of personal notes from that family and others. Goldwater, who I didn't know, but knew people who knew him. And I can just say that the traditional Republicans of the 50s and 60s, and even into the 70s, would have just been shocked and horrified by the Ted Cruzes or the Sarah Palins or the Glenn Becks or the Limbaughs, all these hangers-on and leaders and elected officials, but non-elected officials that shape policy. And so, you know, the Ayn Rand Tea Party types combined with these evangelical crazy people, the sort of people that I profile in And God Said Billy as delusional, those folks have taken the Republican Party and really removed it from mainstream politics. And
Frank, good book, by the way. I want to have you back on and talk about it some more. This is not enough time to really explore this topic, but I appreciate you joining me.
hey, it's been a pleasure. Thanks a lot.